Sum anh chơi những cái chỗ. Ông chúng tôi nhớ một cái mặt to cái trong đại ca để tiếp thì sẵn đại ca tam ca lục hiện để bàn cùng tục nơi ngày đi ông nhớ ra anh chơi mẹ chấm niên David Chandler mẹ chấm niên anh đã chết làm bài một bắt đầu thật cái cam nơi chụp một ông chụp được đây sẽ là tập bùng cái làm chi là người ca ông bị than đập hiệp vật tâm miền phía kỳ nâng bộ cô đại trợ chơi châu ruộng được không đồng là ca nên tệ bị thì sợ là ca tầm rạp ngày đi
xong cột lộc thiên ភិក្ខុដែលត្រូវចូលរួមនៅក្នុងកិច្ចបណ្ណាការនីតិទី3នាការក្នុងថ្ងៃនេះមានវត្តមានគ្រប់ចំនួនអ្នកជំនាញ David Chandler មានវត្តមានរងចាំការកោះហៅពីអង្គជំនុំជម្រះមន្ត្រីតុលាការអញ្ជើញអ្នកជំនាញ
David Chandler ចូលមកកាន់បន្ទប់សម្ណាការ Aaron susdai lok David Chandler cho men upakor oi kot sdap te Mantrei Tulaka samrob mruol oi pdal nei upakor sdap phisa bop prae Arun Susdai, look, David Chandler. Look, David Chandler, ta chmua look pinh linh cứ chmua bay tới.
My full name is David Porter Chandler.
David Porter Chandler.
Look, men ayu paman hai.
76.
Yom men ayu chetsap pramuichnam.
Hai sap ngay ni look men ti lom nu chantrai nu ti na dae.
Oh, in Melbourne, Australia.
Ti krong Melbourne, prote Australia. Australia.
Look, perkop mukrabo abai dae.
I'm a retired professor of history.
Nyom sastraja dae chou ni wat hoy, nyom chi sastraja prawattasah.
Doy pai tam vithien 31.2 nei vithien tei khnong nei ông chúng tôi dùng ra vị sầm anh không tala ca cam bên chia lục đặc biệt chặt lỡ không niềm lục trên đại chấm niềng ông dùng ra đồng rơi ở lục phơ sầm bọt chỉ môn môn đường pro ta khay cắm ta lục yul prom đại rệt tế
yes I do
nhóm yul prom
là bên chia anh ta chiết Natasha sum rep chom nite vithi đam bay nai nom dol lok David Chandler knong ka thveu sambot
Please repeat after me.
I
solemnly declare that I will assist the trial chamber honestly, confidentially, and to the best of my ability.
I solemnly declare that I will assist the trial
chamber honestly, confidentially, and to the best of my ability.
David Chandler,
I worked at Monash University in Australia from 1972 to 1997, and I'm still attached to the university, but I'm technically retired. I can speak and read it. My writing is very hard to read. Yes, I did for many years, indeed from, I think, from 1976 to 1998, I was pretty much concentrating on that period in most of my writings. Yes, I have. I've written two books that are primarily concerned with the Democratic Kampuchean regime. One is a biography of Pol Pot called Brother Number One, and the second is a book about S-21 facility called Voices from S-21. And there are also chapters in my longer history books about this period.
That's
a very good question. I became interested in Cambodia for the first time when I was posted here as an American diplomat in 1960 and 62. At that time, I fell in love with the country and its people, and I followed events here pretty closely in the intervening years. When the Khmer Rouge came to power in 1975, like I think many Khmer people, I was very surprised and upset by what was happening, and I was curious to study this regime to see how and if indeed it could be connected to the rest of Cambodia's very interesting history. Well, I began using text from S21 in the early 1990s when I was writing other books. For instance, my biography of Pol Pot contains some S21 material, but I turned to the study of S21 full-time in 1994, and the book was sent to the publishers in 1998, appeared in 1999, so I spent really 4 years concentrating on S21 in order to produce that book.
I
studied these archives carefully, particularly the ones that had been microfilmed, so I could read those in other countries. When I was doing research here in Cambodia, I worked in the archives at S21 when they were still there, and then at the Tuol Sleng Museum, rather, and then later at the DC CAM archive. So yes, I worked as hard as I could and found as much as I could. I by no means studied the full range of documents, but I think I studied enough to support my findings in my book.
អរគុណតើលោកធ្លាប់បានធ្វើជួបសម្ភាសជាមួយបុគ្គលិកអ្នករស់រានមានជីវិតអ្នករក្សាបណ្ណសារនៅមន្ទីរស-21និងអ្នកផ្សេងទៀតដែលដឹងច្បាស់អំពីរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យដែលរាទេនៅក្នុងអំឡុងពេលដែលលោកសិក្សាស្រាវជ្រាវនោះ
Yes, I interviewed Van Natt a couple times. I also interviewed two of the former guards, Kok Sro and Him Hui. But those were the people, and I also interviewed the photographer, Nam N, who was here, I think, yesterday, the day before. I did not speak to other members of the staff of S21 because they were not available at that time for interviews.
Thank you very much, President. First, Professor Chandler, the trial chamber and the parties are grateful to you for making this long journey to assist us in our search for the truth in this matter. A minor matter first. In answer to the President's question about what material you analyzed for the purposes of your book, the translation said that you had considered more than 1,000 confessions. In fact, from my research, it was significantly more than that number. Am I correct? I have read the figure 4,000. Just a moment, Professor Chandler. I'm afraid the system works by you waiting for the red light, and if I could suggest that you slow down because of the needs for translation into two other languages. Thank you.
Well, thank you for your question. I think I estimated that I myself had actually gone through, I don't know how many ones I went through, but I went through some that seemed interesting. I followed various leads, and then I skipped some that seemed to duplicate other ones. So how many I actually looked at, I'm not sure. I think citations in the book might be to 300 or 400, but I certainly have information on at least 1,000 of the confessions.
Next Now, first I want to put your book formally before the chamber. The title of the book that we are particularly interested in today is Voices from S21, Terror and History in Pol Pot's Secret Prison. English ERN 00192667 to 00192932. Khmer ERN 00191816 to 00192089. French ERN 00357247 to 00357451. Professor Chandler, have you read the response to your book prepared by the accused Gang Gek Yu? ERN number, just forgive me while I put these numbers on the record. ERN number, English 00257452 00257 62 Khmer 01 8 7 4 4 to 00 1 8 7 5 4 to 00 1 8 7 5 4 and French 00 1 8 8 7 5 5 to 00 1 8 8 7 6 8. You will have forgotten my question. It was, have you read the response to your book prepared by the accused Gang Gek Yu?
Yes, I have. Thank you.
Based on your research, have you any comment to make on his statement, in particular as to its insights or accuracy?
I found the statement very interesting. I didn't find it inaccurate in any significant places. I didn't find any special difficulties with the statement.
Thank you. From this point on, I am going to refer to parts of your book using the English page numbers, or we'd be here for several days quoting the ERN numbers to assist you, Professor Chandler, should you need to refer to a particular portion. In your book, you refer to the accused as the author of The Last Plan, which has sometimes been called The Last Joint Plan. You refer to it in several places, page 12 and other page references. On what do you base the conclusion that the accused was the author of that document?
I'm not going to be able to give you a really perfect answer to that question because I haven't seen this document for many years, but my recollection is that one text I saw was actually in his handwriting.
Thank you. The title of your book, or the subtitle of your book, describes it as Terror and History in Pol Pot's Secret Prison. At page 8 of your book, you quote Pol Pot as denying any knowledge of Tu Sleng, saying that he made only big decisions on big issues and asserting that Tu Slang was a Vietnamese exhibition. Given those statements, why do you use that subtitle for your book, Pol Pot's Secret Prison?
An excellent question. There's no way at all that this prison could have existed without the knowledge and approval of the top person in Cambodia at the time, in DK. I think his answer to the question was evasive and might have been had someone asked him about S21, because of course the prison was not known as Tuol Slang in the DK period. But I referred to it as Secret Prison because that's what it was. To my mind, this was the chief interrogation center of the regime, which was run by Pol Pot. This was not the museum may have been to some extent the work of Vietnamese advisors assisted by Khmer, but S21 as a facility between 76 and 79 was certainly not a Vietnamese concoction.
At page 14 of your book, you have begun a description of S21 as a total institution. Could you describe briefly what you intend by that description?
Yes. This is a phrase taken from a American sociologist named Irving Goffman, and he is referring to total institutions as such places as boarding schools, prisons, convents, monasteries, places where it's a closed world where all the rules are made inside that world and there's no very little connection with the outside world. I think this was S21 was certainly a total institution. As I recall, the defendant in his comments on my book agreed with this description of the place as a total institution.
What characteristics of a total institution did you discern in S21? One, for example, at page 15 of your book suggests that secrecy was a high priority of democratic Kampuchean leadership. Is that a characteristic of a total institution in your assessment?
Well, some yes and some no. I mean, when the fact that no information got out of the facility except to the leaders, I'd say that was an indication that it was a total institution. But Goffman uses a wider frame. I mean, he's referring also to hospitals where information can reach the public and so on. It's just a place that makes its own rules and follows its own rules in order to continue doing business. Secrecy was, of course, absolutely central to the whole ideology and behavior of Democratic Cambodia, and Nguyen Chia made this very clear when he was visited by a Danish delegation in 1978. He said that secrecy is, I forget the exact phrasing, but secrecy is the absolute heart of our administration.
You note other characteristics of S21, for example, its hierarchical nature and the imposition of harsh discipline from the accused down. Do you still hold with those assessments?
Yes, indeed. I've read nothing in the intervening 11 years since the book came out, or 10 years the book came out, to change my mind on those particular issues.
I appreciate that you did not focus so much attention on Presor or S24 as on S21 in this book. But from your research, would you consider Presor to have similar characteristics to S21?
It shared some characteristics, certainly, but the fact that people could be released from it was a key feature that made it very, very different. People would come in and go out. It was not a secret facility, people were released. So it was an imprisoning re-education facility, if you like. But it shared, I think, in a way, very few characteristics with S21, very few key characteristics.
At page 22 of your book, you focus on, or you touch on, the accused's character and responsibilities. Have you met or interviewed the accused at any point?
No, I have not.
You described him in this manner as the man in charge of S21. Doik worked hard to control every aspect of its operations. His experiences and instincts from teaching were helpful. He was used to keeping records, ferreting out answers to problems, earning respect, and disciplining groups of people. He drove himself and his subordinates very hard. Quote, he was strong, he was clear, he would do what he said, the former guard Hum Hoi has recalled. Doik often frightened workers at the prison. When asked what kind of man Doik was, another guard replied, quote, ha, what kind of man he was beyond reason. Further on page 22, you say that as a mathematician, he enjoyed rationally pleasing models, citing the last plan in connection with that comment. Am I right in inferring that these conclusions about the character of the accused have been drawn from your interviews and your study of S21 archives?
Yes, indeed.
In the intervening 10 years, is there anything that you have read or considered that might change your mind on these characteristics?
Not really, no.
Thank you. At page 40, you describe S21 as an anteroom to death, a statement with which the accused has agreed. Can you elaborate on that very briefly, please?
Yes, I mean, this was, I mean, an anteroom or a waiting room, whatever word you'd like to, departure lounge, there's all sorts of phrases I could have used. I used the word anteroom because the fate that awaited every single person in S21, except for the handful of survivors and some of the staff, was a forceful and violent death. So some of them knew this or worked it out, some of them did not know this, but the accused and the administrators of the prison knew this very well. So I think they all knew that my description, made years later, of course, was accurate.
Thank you. In one chapter, you analyze the regime's theories concerning its enemies, that's at pages 41-76. And at the beginning, you describe S21 as a total institution whose mission was to locate, question, and destroy the enemies of the party's center.
In what sense do you use the word locate? Do you intend to imply an active role on the part of S21 in tracing and arresting enemies, or do you use that word to describe the role of the accused in his analysis of confessions, locating strings of enemies?
I certainly didn't mean to suggest that S21 had any role in arrests, and I think this is made very clear in some of the other testimony that the chambers have received. Locating the enemies more precisely than the suspicions of other people that had brought these prisoners to S21 was the job of the interrogators and working under the accused's supervision. And so the more precise location of enemies can be derived from the texts, or some of the texts probably, because some of the texts were not helpful in this regard. In locating the enemies, the text would then be forwarded to higher authorities with clearer evidence than their suspicions of the guilt of the people involved.
Thank you. You conclude from the numbers killed at S21 that, and I quote from page 41, S21 was probably the most efficient institution in the country, unquote. And given the emphasis the party center placed on protecting itself from its perceived enemies, quote, S21 was also one of the most important, unquote. Does this remain your conclusion as more information concerning other Santibal has emerged? Sorry, Professor, would you mind? It's a strange system.
But
No, I was warned particularly not to respond promptly to you because you were talking English to me, but, so I'm sorry for the mistake.
But
let me just rethink a little bit here. Yes, the other information that's come through about other prisons in the country, they did not have the same volume of documentation. They did not interrogate prisoners at the same level. Prisoners in the other prisons were not, by and large, active duty soldiers or members of the Communist Party. This was those prisons in the other parts of the country were not administered directly from the top, as it were. This one was administered particularly by Son Sen and perhaps by Nong Chia, working on top of the defendant. I still believe the efficiency of the other prisons, we can't tell how efficient they were because the records for most of them have not survived, but it seems to me they were probably not as mechanically efficient as tool slang with typewriters and telephones and so forth, and also that and not as important because they did not require the day-to-day or attention of some of the top senior people as S21 did.
You also suggest that the party center was convinced that there were enemies everywhere and that it became more concerned about internal than external enemies as the revolution progressed. Is it correct that you conclude that this preoccupation with internal enemies led to two broad phases of purges?
ពីធំធំនៃការបោសសម្អាតនោះ
Yes, I do.
The first of those was from September 1975 to September 1976, and it focused on those associated with the former regime, while the second purge from October 1977 until the end of the regime included those who were suspected of working against the revolution. Is that correct?
Yes.
The first purges inside the regime occurred in the later part of 76 after S-21 had opened in Tuol Sleng. But the second phase was more directly involved purging the different zones, the northwest, the east, so forth, purging the leaders of these zones and their subordinates to try and clean out. suspected and in some cases obviously genuine, I have no idea which ones those were, suspected and genuine enemies of the revolution.
I was going to ask you about your suspicions that some of those purged were genuinely engaged in plots against the regime, possibly involving collusion with the Vietnamese. Was that your tentative view? I think there's a reference at page 57.
It seems to me actuarially impossible that no one in Democratic Kampuchea, in some of the reaches of the, that no one had ever opposed the regime sincerely, and also that it seems unthinkable that no one during the DK regime would have preferred Cambodia to operate in ways that they believed Vietnam was operating after its communist victory. Now, having said that, that doesn't mean that I'm in any position to point at particular prisoners or particular conspiracies and say that these are the genuine ones. It seems to me these conspiracies, they had to occur. The idea that they would not occur is just impossible to believe.
In fact, from 1976 on, you noted some changes in the composition of the prisoners at S-21, and also noted changes in the allegations made concerning links with Vietnam. Did this, in fact, coincide with that second purge when external enemies were being targeted?
Yes, I mean, in the second phase, to call someone Vietnamese in Democratic Kampuchea did not mean that you were ethnically Vietnamese. It meant that you were opposed to the regime. If you were the regime, you were, quote, objectively, unquote, Vietnamese or CIA or any of the other things they accuse people of. But yes, I mean, after September 76, when some of those, there's a certain amount of difficulty at the party center at this time, and in the summer of 1976, some high-ranking cadre from the eastern zone came into S-21, raising suspicions at the party center that higher-ranking figures in the eastern zone, including members of the central, were involved in a conspiracy against the regime. Eastern zone, of course, is the one that borders Vietnam and the one that had the highest number of cadre who had fought in the first Indochina war alongside the Vietnamese and also in the civil war with extensive Vietnamese guidance. So these people came under suspicion of the party center as people who would be likely or suspected of harboring Vietnamese preferences, our preferences for Vietnam over Cambodia.
And that targeting of those who were assumed to be sympathetic towards Vietnam coincided with a series of cross-border raids into Vietnam during which, and I quote from your book at page 61, hundreds of civilians were massacred in these incursions, which were not publicized in either country, unquote. Is that correct, that these incursions coincided with an increasing suspicion of links with Vietnam?
Yes, indeed.
Are you able to assist us in explaining why the incursions might not have been publicized in either country?
Well, the Vietnamese had their victory was less than 2 years old. They were not in a position or had the political will to go to war against Cambodia at this stage. They felt that these raids might have been I don't know what the Vietnamese leadership thought, but it seems to me they might well have thought that these raids were the ideas of some hot-headed junior officials who would then be pushed by the party center, that this idea couldn't possibly have come from all of his colleagues. The Cambodians didn't want to publicize these attacks because, of course, these are cross-border attacks. These were, in fact, mini invasions that they didn't want to be part of. They wanted to attack Vietnam, Vietnam, ironically, that had fairly high numbers of ethnic Khmer in them, hoping, I think, completely in a completely deluded fashion, that the Khmer minority would then come over to DK and support DK and also seek to secede from southern Vietnam. This is one of the many delusionary ideas that were in the heads of the party leadership. The raids themselves, rather sadly, I found from a couple of interviews, these raids were carried out at night, and the raiders couldn't see who they were killing, and in fact, in many cases, they killed ethnic Khmer who were in these villages, whereas many of the ethnic Vietnamese had fled in advance back into some of the towns. So it's just a tragic mess of these incursions. But yes, neither side wanted to admit that they were taking place. The Vietnamese, something might be ironed out. The Cambodians had other hopes that didn't turn out.
At the same stage, you discuss purges of diplomatic and diplomatic representatives and intellectuals, that is, starting in 1976. To what do you ascribe the purges of those classes of people?
Well, these were diplomats, of course, were people who had been in touch with foreigners. They were out people, if you like, from your earlier questions, who were living outside the total institution and outside its control, and consequently were suspected of maybe forming alliances or agreements with foreign powers. Intellectuals were not pursued because they were intellectuals. They were pursued because certain high-ranking members of the particularly Khoi Thuan came under suspicion. And he was a relatively well-educated Khmer, and his circle of friends and the people he'd come into the party with, many of them were well-educated Khmer, which is the definition of, I guess, intellectual in Cambodian society are people with a certain amount of formal education, in this case, education in French. And so ripples sort of spread out from Khoi Tuan and from others who had been well educated. And another factor, of course, was that many of these so-called intellectual cadre had been sent to the northwest to administer that area, the area that was most full of April 17th people, people who had had no experience or ability at farming. Catastrophic events occurred, and many of these are cataloged in survivors' accounts. And at the center, unwilling or unable to believe that it was their disease that had caused or accelerated these catastrophic events, believed as following the Russian model of the 1930s that people were deliberately wrecking those policies, and these had to be the people in charge, these had to be their cadre. In the Northwest, these people happened to fall into the category of intellectuals.
Professor Chandler, can I ask you again to slow down? You didn't get that?
Metal.
You're asking me to ask the professor to slow down, are you? We just to explain the technical issues here, Professor Chandler, your answers are translated into Khmer and into French. This takes quite a while, and we all need to speak very slowly, like I'm speaking now. Even if you could pause, I know it's asking a lot because you are thinking and speaking. But if you could, because your testimony is valuable to the chamber. At page 74 of your book, you speak of the final purges when nearly 100 Vietnamese prisoners of war were purged. This is at the end of 1978. And also Von Vett, a deputy prime minister, and Cheng An, a deputy minister for industry, who were purged on a suspicion that they were mobilizing former factory workers. From where did you take the draw the conclusion that the arrests of Von Vett and Cheng An were associated with the purging of a large number of former factory workers?
Well, I'm sure I got that from the documentation. The purges in 1978, they were slowing down at S21. But groups that were targeted were groups that included or could mobilize large numbers of able-bodied men. In other words, the railway workers were purged, the industrial workers were purged, and this was a way of, I guess, postponing what the regime felt might be a possibility of mobilizing some of these able-bodied men in a way that could, in order to overthrow the regime.
With your permission, President, may I ask the AV unit to screen ERN number
0033130.
Thank you. you will see from that chart which has already been put before the chamber, Professor Chandler, that in 1976, from the documents that are available to us, 1,963 people were arrested, rising sharply in 1977 to 5,790 arrests and falling, though not back to the 1976 level, to 2,879 in 1978. Does that chart accord with your assessment of the ages throughout this period of 3 years?
Yes, it does.
Thank you. You can return the AV screen.
Thank you.
You found some evidence to suggest that in late 1978, efforts might have been made to restrain the purges as they got out of hand. Nonetheless, at page 75 of your book, you come to this conclusion. Reigns of terror and continuous revolutions in democratic Kampuchea, the two phenomena overlapped, require a continuous supply of enemies. When these enemies are embedded in a small, inexperienced political party, ethnically indistinguishable from the majority of the population, attempting to purge all its enemies can have disastrous effects. As Doik and his colleagues did what they were told, they undermined Cambodia's military effectiveness, dismantled the administrative structure of the country, and destroyed the party. The killing machine at S21 had no brakes because the paranoia of the party center had no limits. That is the end of my quote. Am I correct in inferring from that quote that you considered the options at S21 to be pivotal to the fulfillment of party centers' objectives in controlling its enemies?
Yes, I do.
You have discussed extensively the archive at S21, and you note first at page 49 that this archive was not unique. You have described it as being part of an extensive documentation of the democratic Kampuchea regime. In your view, was the archive at S21 more expansive and detailed than other parts of the Democratic Kampuchean archive, or are you unable to make the assessment because of the inability to access other archives for other parts of the Santibal apparatus?
I'm pretty sure the archives of S21 were the most extensive in the Santibal apparatus. There are extensive archives from the Ministry of Defense, archives from the Ministry of dealing with defense matters. It's anomalous to talk about ministries. And also archives that deal with foreign trade. There obviously were other archives which have either disappeared forever or are hidden away some places where they're presently inaccessible. I have no idea about the size of these archives. My suspicion would be that these archives, such as those of the Party Center itself, would have been less extensive than those of Tuol Sleng. These would have been working archives of particularly sensitive materials, rather than the voluminous hundreds of thousands of pages that were assembled at S21.
Would I be correct in inferring then that under the leadership of the accused, the archive at S21 was kept in a particularly professional way and in great detail?
Yes, you can certainly infer that.
You have concluded at page 49 of your book that the S21 archive, the contents of it, were secret, that much of the content of the confessions were palpably untrue, and that all the prisoners were killed. What then do you conclude was the purpose of the S21 archive?
All your questions have been excellent. That seems to be a particularly key question that is impossible to answer. Perhaps the defendant can give a clear answer as to what he thought or believed was being done when he was in charge of assembling this archive. But it seems to me that one purpose of the assembling this archive was to demonstrate to the leadership that S21 was a thoroughly responsible, efficient, modern, and productive body inside the government, inside a country where conditions were, in many places, as wide evidence suggests, completely chaotic from day to day. That's one purpose, to demonstrate the professionalism of the defendant and his colleagues. Another was to inform the top leadership in as much detail as possible whether and in what way its suspicions were justified for certain prisoners, and to uncover strings of traitors, Vietnamese agents, and so forth, that would give information to the leadership that it could then use for its own purposes. And finally, this is speculation, but it's an intriguing idea that was suggested to me by a colleague, that one purpose of assembling this mighty archive was that it might serve as a source for a triumphant and triumphal history of the Communist Party of Cambodia, in much the same way as documents were funneled into the history of the Soviet Union, Communist Party of the Soviet Union, demonstrating that that party, in essence, was one that had destroyed all of its enemies. Now, that is the last one is speculation. The first one seems to be quite obvious, that they were trying their very best to do a good job, and consequently they weren't going to be slipshod in their methodology or their written work. The second one that they were, I think, is also obvious, that they were trying very conscientiously to serve what they perceived as the needs of the leadership, which changed, of course, from, as you've said earlier, from year to year, month to month, and often even day to day. So it was, there were several purposes, in other words, for the archives being assembled in the way it was.
Thank you very much. You will have noted from the accused's response to your book that he placed great emphasis on the 30th of March 1976 document, Decisions of the Central Committee regarding a number of matters, English ERN 00180809 to 00180 Khmer 00000758 to 00000754 and French 00224363 to 00224367. Are you familiar with this document, Decisions of the Central Committee regarding a number of matters, to which you refer briefly at page 51 of your book? We can have it displayed on the screen, the first. Perhaps it could be displayed so that the parties can refresh their memories. It's already been put before the court through, I believe, Dr. Richardson. Could the AV unit display the English, please? Do you have the ERN number? 00182809. Thank you. That first section is the most critical one in the view of the accused. My question to you, Professor Chandler, is what significance do you place on this document?
Well, I think it's the closest we've got to a, if you like, a smoking gun authorizing the smashing of enemies in the of DK. Of course, this document was extremely closely held. There are only six or seven copies made and only one of these copies survived by chance. It was discovered in, with a few other of these documents, I think, in 1980 in somebody's house. If we had all the cabinet documents that must have been assembled in this small group, we would have a completely new history of DK. So these are very crucial documents coming right from the top and authorizing the decisions to smash enemies inside and outside the ranks, ranks beating, of course, the CPK.
Thank you. The AV unit can return the screen to the normal position, please. In a key part of your book, you describe and analyze interrogations at S21, starting from a premise that the detainees had not been accused because they were guilty. They were guilty because they had been accused. And in your opinion, this underpinned the interrogator's role, which was, to quote you, to validate the verdict by extracting full confessions. Have you noted that in his response to you, to your book rather, at paragraph 3, ERN English 00270555, the accused affirms that assessment by quoting, better arrest 10 people by mistake than free one wrongly, going on to say, it was a legitimate accusation of my people who suffered considerably from constant brutal arrests. Son Sen, and perhaps other Khmer Rouge leaders as well, used a phrase, quote, no gain in keeping, no loss in weeding out, unquote. I assume that you still hold the view that you expressed that this approach underpinned the interrogator's role.
Yes, I do.
You also suggest at page 80 of the book that the vast majority of prisoners at S21 were killed both because of their supposed guilt, but also, and I quote, because of the existence of the prison, its location, and its purposes needed to be kept secret. I infer from that that the requirement to keep the prison secret was part of the upper echelon's objective, but was also assiduously maintained by the chair of the prison, the accused gang
gek.
Yes, that's right. I mean, and so it's not just a question of better arrest 10 people by mistake and then to let one go wrongly. Of course, the horror of S21, and perhaps the reason why we're one of the many reasons we're assembled here today, is it wasn't to arrest people by mistake; it's in fact to kill people by mistake, and that has just a chilling aspect to it.
Thank you. You make a number of important conclusions from your confessions. I'm interested, and you've already touched briefly on this, but I'm interested in your references to long-standing CIA, KGB, or Vietnamese affiliations, which you refer to at pages 81 to 82 and page 94. From your analysis of the confessions, did you come to a conclusion on any occasion that affiliations with the CIA and KGB might have been realistic assumptions on the part of the interrogators?
Well, I think that's a very good question. I think the interrogators had no idea what realistic assumption was, in one of the quotes later in the book. Two of the interrogators later in their confession say they didn't even know what CIA was. It was just CIA was what you had to accuse the prisoner of belonging to. I think It was a catchphrase for enemies. Later on, the KGB was introduced as another enemy, and the Vietnamese came third, I think. But the idea that, at least the confessions I've read, the idea that any of the people accused of this affiliation had, in fact, genuine links to the Central Intelligence Agency seemed to me entirely far-fetched. And I think it's quite possible that the accused was aware of this but was following directions from above. The interrogators, it seems to me, probably didn't know and may not even have cared whether the charges were accurate or not. They were the charges they were required to make.
Thank you. You isolate two methods used to get confessions, one, quote, doing politics, and the other, quote, imposing torture. Can you elaborate briefly on these two methods?
Certainly, imposing torture means to begin a range of activities against the prisoner's body that could be defined by all the international treaties we know of, I think probably as torture. Doing politics is a more complicated area. This is everything but torture. This was questioning, cajoling, getting to know, trying to undermine, trying to befriend, trying to contradict, all these kind of interrogatory methods, some of them quite professional, professionally done, others done in extremely amateur fashion, as ways of getting a confession without torture. And I think it's impossible to know how much torture was used, and it's quite possible, indeed I think it's likely, that some confessions reached a satisfactory, from the point of view of the accused and his colleagues, a satisfactory conclusion with minimal or almost no torture. So doing politics was the verbal method, and I think in some cases, I don't know which ones, it was successful. In other words, prisoners confessed in a satisfactory way without being tortured.
Thank you. I'm going to interrupt at this point to ask whether Professor Chandler's microphone is malfunctioning to the extent that it's difficult to for the interpreters. Can the interpreters still hear, and are we getting a record? No, nothing's your fault, Professor Chandler.
In
the context of torture, you quote from notes from an interrogator's notebook at page 135. I assume that you have studied that notebook extensively and drawn some of your conclusions on torture and its methods from it. Am I correct in that?
Yes, you are. I came across these notebooks quite late in my research, and they were really quite revelatory and useful because they were coming from the inside. People, I think, talking sincerely about these issues as they confronted them in the prison.
Thank you. You also emphasize the practice of preparation of biographies. In your opinion, was this a new technique developed during the Democratic Kampuchea era, and was it confined solely as a practice to those being interrogated, or was it used more broadly?
The business of writing biographies was one of the major industries, autobiographies, one of the major industries of DK. Everybody in the party certainly had to write extensive autobiographies which are kept on file. The employees of S21 wrote autobiographies which have been very, I think, helpful in the proceedings here. People would then revise them or be asked to write new ones later. And the prisoners at S21 were asked to write their autobiography in much the same way as members of the party had been asked to write theirs, in order to outline what they had done in their life and where they came from. But when it came to shortcomings, a line in the biographies given to party members and people at the prison, prisoners did not list personal shortcomings, but were made to launch into long descriptions of treasonous activity.
Was the writing of biographies traditional in Cambodia before the Democratic Kampuchea period?
No, I don't think so at all. It was not a common practice. There were very few biographies written. People were never, of course, compelled to write them. I imagine some of the procedures from S21 came from pre-revolutionary police practice. In other words, I think prisoners in the colonial and post-colonial eras in Cambodia, probably before they were interrogated or after they'd been arrested, had to produce a certain short autobiographical information about where they lived, who their parents were, what their job had been, and so on. So there's a little bit of a precedent in the judicial system, but not in the culture as a whole. There was none at all that I could see.
Would I be correct in inferring that biographies of ordinary cadres at S21 became a source of information for the regime to identify its enemies, or was there some less sinister purpose?
I don't think there's any sinister purpose in making requiring members of the staff of S21 prepare biographies. This was just something that party people and military people had to do from time to time. I would say this was not, the purpose was just, it was just a practice that was universal. The people didn't mind, or maybe they did, but it was a required activity, and so I think it was just one of the normal features of life at the prison, and probably at other offices throughout the country, except that the difference that these other autobiographical documents have not survived, whereas those connected with S21 have survived.
In your analysis of prisoners' confessions, you drew some other interesting conclusions. One, for example, was that little information emerged from those confessions about their daily life, but that you could infer that food and hygiene was seriously deficient. Does that lack of detail surprise you?
Well,
Not really. I mean, the people at S21 really didn't care at all about the personal details of the lives of the people who were brought in to be interrogated. But they wanted to find out or to confirm were the guilt of these people that had been sent there from other places and what was happening in their daily lives was of no interest. Of course, many of the confessions contained helpful information about what was going on and why these people were unhappy, sometimes sincerely unhappy with the regime, particularly some of the lower-ranking soldiers are often quite frank about what they didn't like, and they didn't like not having any free time, didn't like not having enough food, didn't like not being able to go home. And these things, these elements of daily discomfort, if you like, creep into the confessions. But the, those of most of the prisoners don't contain details of this kind.
Thank you. At
page 120 of your book, you make certain assertions concerning the judicial system in Cambodia after the Khmer Rouge victory on the 17th of April, 1975. Can you summarize those conclusions, please?
Certainly, well, there were no laws, no judges, no lawyers, no courts in democratic Cambodia. There's a court that was mentioned in its constitution, and a judge was named to head that court, who was later purged at S21, but no trials took place. This was similar to other communist countries where revolutionary law was not did not take coded form, and where trials were not take a form that would be recognizable to us here or in other countries. So the judicial system, in fact, disappeared. And what remained of the judicial system was the interrogatory. The capacity of a certain institution to interrogate prisoners and get information, possibly in another society, that would aid a judicial prosecution. But as we know, and as the defendant has said, the judicial system of MDK was incomplete in the sense that there was no subsequent body that was going to deal with the information that had been gathered at S21. That was, if you like, that was the one element of the judicial system that remained, was the questioning capacity of this institution and perhaps other institutions as well.
Thank you. I want to return briefly to the topic of torture. As you suggested, it was practiced at S21. At page 130, you list a large number of instances of torture which you found mentioned in the archive and by survivors. Does that remain your assessment of the methods of torture used at S21?
Yes, it does. I'm sure all these, I found these methods cited in the archives or by survivors. There are probably, I'm not, I've been keeping that close tabs, there are probably other tortures that were also conducted at the prison that I didn't find evidence for, and these have come to light since I wrote the book.
Well, perhaps for the record, I will set out the list that you put at page 130, beating by various methods, cigarette burns, electric shock, forced to eat excrement, forced to drink urine, forced feeding, hanging upside down, holding arms up for an entire day, being jabbed with a needle, paying homage to images of dogs, all from 1978, paying homage to the wall, to the table, to the chair, having fingernails pulled out, scratching, shoving, suffocation with a plastic bag, and methods of water tortures. Much of that list includes serious instances of violence which might well be characterized ultimately as torture. But I wonder about scratching and shoving. Do you recall those terms, and why would you list them as so serious as being torture?
I see your point. I think those two persons might be taken away from the list if you're trying to bring all the invasions of privacy, if you like, under the rubric of torture as term international conventions. But I was trying to get every time that a guard or an interrogator did something to a prisoner that was, in fact, an invasion of that prisoner's body. But I agree, those two, actually, when you were reading them out, I felt that those two items might well have been taken off the list. I think your idea is right there, that perhaps they should not be included.
You go on to say that the list doesn't include many of the tortures depicted in Van Natt's paintings, and I assume that you learned of those methods after you had completed your study of the archive.
Yeah, I mean, I interviewed Van Natt, and I was a great admirer. I've been an admirer of his for many years, but I wanted to be particularly sure that these tortures depicted in his paintings were ones that he had actually seen, and not ones that he had heard about second or third hand, or ones that he might have even been told to paint. And these would seem to be ones that where I was unable to verify that these tortures took place at Tuol
Sleng. Recently, Professor Chandler, the trial chamber heard the testimony of Cox Ross, a former worker at S21. You interviewed him and quoted him extensively in your book. It was notable from his testimony that 10 years later, he was unable to recall accurately many of the statements ascribed to him by you. Are you able to tell us how you recorded your interviews with him, and if necessary, whether the trial chamber could access any such records?
I interviewed him in Khmer with another person there who would amplify some of his remarks, so I wasn't understanding them perfectly. I think I had a small tape recorder, I'm almost sure I did, but I think those transcriptions are no longer in my possession. I don't have the material in any shape or form able to provide to the chambers at this time.
ក្នុងទម្រង់ណាមួយដើម្បីផ្ដល់ជូន
ផ្លាកា
សមកពេលនេះទេជាក្រុមសូមអរគុណ
Finally at the end of your book you quote the accused and you say that at a livelihood meeting convened by Chan for S21 staff in February 1976, Doik himself is recorded as saying to his colleagues, quote, "You must rid yourselves of the view that beating the prisoners is cruel. Kindness is misplaced in such cases. You must beat them for national reasons, class reasons, and international reasons." Unquote. That is to be found at page 152 of your book. The accused has not confirmed that he made that exact statement at that time or in that context. Are you able to assist the trial chamber providing some information about its derivation at page 206, footnote 25, you refer to it as an uncatalogued item from S21 archive, 18 February 1976.
Yeah, before I answer your question, I want to just amplify a little bit my response to the question earlier. I was very fortunate, I think, that my interview with him in 1995, I'm not sure it's in the book, that was the first interview he'd had. He had not been interviewed by anyone else, been found and brought into Phnom Penh to talk to me. And it was for that reason that I felt the things he was saying had a particular freshness, because he'd never been questioned before. So that's why I'm sort of, in a way, defending what I think was the accuracy of what he said at that time. But to go on to this other question, this was, of course, in the late 1990s, 10 years ago. There were hundreds and thousands even of documents that were in the S21 archive transferred en masse to DC Cam that had not yet been catalogued or numbered by that institution. Now, I'm sure nowadays, or pretty sure anyway, knowing the terrific efficiency of that institution, that perhaps by the date or some other method, this document could be retrieved from their own archives. But I've, of course, not had any reason to do this since the publication of my book.
Oh, thank you very much, Professor Chandler. That is the extent of the questions that I wished to put to you, Mr. President. Do you wish to adjourn at this point?
The President, it is now a convenient time to take an adjournment. So we will adjourn
ចាប់ពីម៉ោងនេះទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង11:10នាទីសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញមន្ត្រីតុលាការត្រូវរំរួលផ្ដល់កន្លែងសម្រាប់សំរុំទៅដល់អ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះក្នុងអំឡុងពេលសម្រាប់ហើយនឹងឲ្យអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់សាលាសម្រាប់ការមុនបានមុនម៉ោងកំណត់
សូមអញ្ជើញក្រោយចូល